My name is Ronke Adelakun, and I am the writer and the director of the Black Stories Matter film. The whole inspiration behind the film was really, for me, the death of George Floyd. It hit differently. It was an intense yet intimate kind of pain. Watching that murder, that barbaric execution, it touched something deep inside. Maybe it was the fact that we were in lockdown and we had been for a while and I'd had a chance to sit with my thoughts. But I think the real trigger was Amy Cooper. You know, watching her weaponize her whiteness in Central Park by calling the police simply because a black man had asked her to follow the rules, to put her dog on a leash, and saying that a black man was threatening her, making that false accusation in order to use a police force that's supposedly there to protect and serve as foot soldiers for her act of violence. That is what really triggered me. From that, it was clear that black people had been under attack for a while. And, you know, racism didn't just exist across the pond or on TV. It was here. It was in our schools. It was in our hospitals. It was in our workplaces. Yet the whole world just stood by and just feigned innocence as if it wasn't happening. The overwhelming emotion for me, watching the murder of George Floyd, I was angry, but it wasn't anger that inspired me, it was helplessness, you know? It was feeling like we were dying and nobody cared. I think a lot of people feel like the UK isn't racist, but the UK does have a race problem and we are in denial. I mean, we saw it recently with Meghan and how she was treated and how she still is treated. And we saw it with the death of Richard Okorogeye and how his mother was treated by the Met Police. The people who have to bear the brunt and the burden of racism are black people. We are forced to carry the burden, yet we're expected to walk on eggshells around it, as if it doesn't exist. In truth, I didn't realize how much pain I myself had endured and how much trauma I kept buried inside. You know, for me, it was all part of the hustle, the price you pay for being a black person working in the corporate world. And it wasn't until that day in Piccadilly Gardens where I knelt and I shouted and I protested and I chanted for George's death and the death of all the other victims of racism and the pain of all the other victims of racism. It was in telling my story, in fighting, that I felt freedom. You know, it's often said that history is written by the victors. Well, if that's the case, we have to make our stories so loud that they echo through the pages of history. These are our stories, and every single one of them matters.
listen, and I've got big news. Hang on, let me just get Amma on this
you
call.
You sound so excited. What's yes. going on?
Wait. Amma needs to be on this. I need to share it to you guys at the same time. Okay. Let me just ring her. Hey.
Hey, you okay?
Hey, Amma. Apparently, Kemi has some big news. Spill the tea, sis.
Well, you need to put some respect on my name because you are now speaking to the newest software developer at Summer Spring!
Oh my god!
Thanks, guys!
I'm not gonna lie, I knew you could do it. Wow.
You know what? People always say that, but the assessment center was mad. Like, yeah, it's all God, man.
You had an internship at Google. Like, who was really gonna say no to you?
Wow, tell us everything. What are the perks? Like, give us all the details.
So, yeah, like, the onboarding process has already been amazing. Apparently, like, they have a gym, they have females at work, even a yoga studio, like.
Come on! Wow, girl, you are really about to be where the money resides.
Where the money resides, where the money resides, where the money resides, where the money resides.
Hey!
Okay, so when are you taking us to dinner, please? Because
that's what I want to know.
Cash in.
Yes, girl, rich best friend perks.
Right. Oh, actually, I really wanted to go to the Ivy. Mm-hmm. You know, cocktails are incredible.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Okay, guys, fine. I will spring for dinner on one condition. So, Shade, my hair needs to be laid for my first week of work. So, will you please do me the honor?
Girl, I've got you. We can binge watch I May Destroy You.
Listen, yeah, the way my back is set up, I can't do those 8-hour braiding marathons anymore.
Amma, don't think you're getting off lightly, yeah? I need my work wardrobe to be killer for when I start. So, you are going to be taking me shopping, yes?
Does this mean you're finally going to update your wardrobe?
Look, Shade, you're not really one to talk, are you?
I have two kids. What's your excuse?
Oh, the shade of it all.
Wow, you guys can't even let somebody be great. Not even for one day.
Then who would keep you humble?
Amma and I are doing a public service.
Right?
Anyway, shopping and then dinner on Saturday. Everybody in?
Yes, girl. We are here to celebrate.
I'm so excited, you guys. It's going to be so good.
So well. You should be really pleased.
Yeah. Anyway, what else is going on with you guys? Shadi, how have you been?
My sisters are the spine in my back, the swagger in my step, the warriors by my side. On the bad days, where it feels like I'm slowly suffocating, they manifest oxygen, speak life into my lungs, and remind me to breathe. When I am drowning and waves of worry drag me down, they become two floats holding me up and remind me I can swim. When it gets dark, man, does it get dark? They are two candles lighting my steps, urging me forward. But on the good days, oh, the good days, our laughter is the sweetest harmony. So we laugh for hours. When it feels like the world is sprinkled with magic, I save the highlights of my day like stardust. I recite it back to them as beautiful bedtime stories. On those nights, I have the sweetest dreams. Our adventures, because we love a good adventure, they remind me that life is worth living, if only for the pleasure of getting to live it with them.
I spent the entire weekend redoing Jamie's mistakes. So, yeah, that's how my weekend ended so abruptly.
That's so annoying. My goodness. Like, ugh.
Story of my life, man.
Yeah, girl.
Kemi, are you messaging someone?
Sorry, I've been trying to like send off this email, but I'm actually like so annoyed.
Why? What's like, going on?
Some of the things that I've been experiencing at work, it's just, it's like, not at all what I thought it would be. Like, I feel like I've got a weird case of what I wanted versus what I got. Like, you guys know I was so excited to start my job, right?
Yeah.
Like, I've always dreamed of working in tech. I've worked so hard for it. And actually, like, being in corporate, it's so different. I think maybe I was a little naive going in because...
In what sense?
You know, I'm like... I'm one of the few black people that are over there at Summer Spring.
Yeah.
And I really didn't think it was going to be an issue. I thought, you know, cool. But actually being there, like, it's different. It's weird.
Mm. In what way?
So, like, you know, my first few days, I was really, really excited. A few people complimented me. They were like, oh, you speak such good English. I was just like, oh, yes, like, making a good impression.
Okay.
But then I realised, like, none of the other graduates got complimented that way.
Mm.
When I really thought about it, that's not a compliment. Like, it sounds like a compliment, but it's not. Like, I got a job at Summer Spring, one of literally the most competitive graduate programmes in the world. And you're commending me on speaking basic English.
Right.
Like, did you expect it less of me? And like, I don't know, since then it's just been sort of like grating at me every time someone says it. Like, but you know what? That's not even like the big one, right? That's not even the one that like turned my whole week sour.
What happened?
The one was at one of the induction talks. There was this lady, she was trying to banter during her induction talk. Then, literally, she's at the front giving a presentation, stops the whole talk to have a discussion about my braids.
No!
Literally in front of everyone. The whole, like, new graduate class was there.
What did you say?
It was literally me giving a seminar to everyone about the history.
So awkward.
You know the questions, how long did it take, blah, blah, blah.
No,
is it your real hair? And I just thought...
Irrelevant.
Honestly. And the bit that got me is that she walked all the way from the front to where I was.
Lord.
And she put her hand into my hair. No permission, no nothing. Nothing. Like, she just started touching my brain, started stroking them.
No.
And I literally thought, in what other situation would you think it was okay to put your hand on somebody else, invade their personal space?
Mm.
In the middle of a talk as well.
In the middle of a talk.
You're not an animal at the zoo. Like,
honestly,
what is that?
I literally felt like an animal at the zoo. And everybody was watching.
Oh, Lord.
And like, oh, I was burning inside. My skin was crawling. But I just had to like hold it all in, not get angry. But I was, guys, I was seething.
Yeah.
I was seething, but it's too early. It's too early in the game to be that angry black woman. So I had to. But honestly, guys, it really got under my skin.
Mm.
Really got under my skin, and nobody said anything. They all just saw it, and nobody said anything. And then on top of that, I had to deal with my supervisor all week. He's been calling my name wrong right from day one, and each time I would correct him, and he'd call it wrong again, and I'd correct him again. And I literally had to do, you know, the phrase pronunciation,
O-lu-wa-ke-mi,
each time. And you wouldn't believe the cheek of this man, right? He turns around to me, and he says, can I call you Lou?
Lou.
Luke, of all the parts of the place that chose Lou, do I look like a Lou?
Lou who?
I had to tell him, no, you can't call me Lou.
Yeah.
Call me Kemi. But not Lou.
That's what my
just name. Like, he uses the excuse of my name is difficult to pronounce, but it's not. If there was a guy there called Tchaikovsky, you wouldn't ask him, oh, can I call you Chai? No. you'd find a way to pronounce the name Tchaikovsky and you'd say it with your chest. Mm-hmm. But with me, you seem to think it's okay to try and whitewash my name. No, I'm not okay with it. And no. I just wish I went in better prepared. I wish I knew how hard it was going to be.
Yeah.
Like, and it's only the first week.
Girl.
I'm sorry about that. I feel like working in the corporate world, it is a balance between what battles to fight and what to brush off.
Yeah.
Mm. And like, being a person of colour in a predominantly white space is not easy.
Yeah.
Mm. You know, and if you try and fight every single battle, you quickly get labelled as difficult.
Mm.
You know? Like for me, at Curtis & Co., I'm one of the only 3 black people there. So, you know, you feel that pressure to be a good representation of blackness. You know what I mean? You already have that. So I don't have an excuse but to be excellent.
Yes, girl. Yeah.
Because I don't want to give them an excuse to not hire another black person.
Mm. Yeah. I mean, I can completely relate to you girls. Like, when I got back to work after maternity leave, you know, I was so hyped, so ready to get back into things. And we had a couple of new starters, you know. But when they saw me, they assumed that I was the cleaner, when in fact I was their manager.
Wow. And
it's like some of these things are so jarring, like that you think I'm the cleaner, you're handing me your trash. I'm your manager. For me to have to correct that assumption that you had, it's so embarrassing. Like, why do you assume that I'm the cleaner?
Well, it should be embarrassing for them.
Honestly. Yeah, but somehow it inevitably makes me uncomfortable as well, because I'm just like, like, why is that your first thought?
Yeah.
So it gets really awkward, and I can't think about it too hard, because if I think about it too hard, I let it get under my skin, I would just explode. Mm.
Yeah. No, I can definitely relate to that too. Like, oh, it's just like, at the moment I'm doing the bulk of Jamie's work, another person's job.
Mm.
And I have to act like I'm okay with it.
Mm.
Like, I can't show them that I'm upset about it. Just be polite. You have to keep calm and rise above it and not
always rising above.
And some of the things they say, even, it's just pure, like, does it stem from ignorance? Like, what?
It is ignorance.
Like, even outside of work, not even in the office, even outside of work, say there's like a negative story in the news, I am willing it not to be a black person.
Honestly, girl.
Because I swear, if it is, they want to know. They want to ask me questions. As if I'm the representative of all black people. They want to know my opinions on it. And it's like, if it was a white person, like if I saw something on the news, I wouldn't even think.
Yeah, right?
I wouldn't go in and be like, Monday morning, oh, what do you think of that person who killed X amount of white people with a white person? I wouldn't even think to say that.
It wouldn't cross your mind. It just wouldn't, like.
Right. So why do they feel the need to ask me all these questions when it's a black person?
Mm-hmm.
And it's just so draining having patients. Like, they have to, you know, educate them politely.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
It can be so exhausting.
Mm-hmm. Like, I completely agree, girls. Like, I think one thing that's helped me is finding somebody else who's, you know, similar to me, from a similar background, who can relate to what I'm going through, who, when things happen, because we can't challenge every single thing that happens in the workplace, but when somebody's experienced the same thing as you, they completely understand what you're walking through. And it just helps to feel heard, to feel seen, to feel listened to feel understood, because I feel like part of what drives us crazy is not knowing, is this in my head, or did this person just come up to me and like attack me? They chose violence this morning, but like, I just have to go about and do my job. Like,
you have to,
honestly, girls. And like, you know, I think one thing that keeps me going is thinking about all the women who have paved the way for us, all the black women who have dealt with what we're dealing with, or even much worse in the past.
And it's not easy, it's not fair, it's a huge burden to carry. But we do this, we go to work and we fight these battles, and we hope that things will be better for the next Kemi, the next Ama, and the next Shade, you know?
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah. So.
Thank you so much, girls. Honestly, it just, like, as hard as it is, it's nice to know, like, I'm not the only one, do you know what I mean? But it's so sad that we're all still going through this. Like, yeah, we're all still experiencing it.
It's just crazy. But
let's just talk about something else, because it's very depressing to just think about this.
Okay.
Outside of work.
What have I been up to? Oh, I've actually got a date coming up soon.
Ooh, okay. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, that's something. I'm so excited for it. Yeah, it's a blind date, so we'll see how it goes.
My blackness is the first voice to announce itself when I walk into a room. It doesn't want to, but this mahogany skin is the elephant that can't stay hidden. It would much rather tiptoe and stand in the back behind all the actual facts about me. But it never gets a chance. Always drawn to attention by your preconceptions. Your misconstrued assumptions become my first impression.
Tell me, why do you feel the need to remind me of the color of my skin? To tell me how you know somebody like me, how your neighbor is black, or is it your best friend? What makes you think black people are a monolith? So much so that you try to make us fit into your cookie cutter cutout of what a black person should be. Do you tell everyone you meet about that time you visited Africa? Or do you think I have a vested interest simply because of the color of my skin?
What aspect of my blackness fascinates you so much that you made it your mission to measure it on a scale just to tell me I don't meet the mark? When I tell you I listen to a bit of Sweet Symphony, what makes you assume I mean the Jay-Z remix? Because God forbid a black girl likes indie rock. And when you find out I don't know how to twerk, be sure to point out that I dance like a white girl. Say it with unmerited confidence, as if you have the authority to revoke my black card.
And when I string together a basic sentence, commend me on being so articulate, as if English is not my first language, as if my education wasn't more rigorous than yours, as if my ability to speak has defied the laws of physics.
And when you make a racist comment, be shocked.
Act as if those rebel words grew legs and crawled out of your mouth.
Try to walk it back, but remind me that I'm different. Not like those other black people.
Remind me of how I'm thriving in spite of my blackness.
No, better yet, credit all my accomplishments to my blackness.
Attribute it to affirmative action or tokenism.
And when you're done, go peacefully about your day.
As though you didn't bring a hailstorm down on mine.
Hello? Yes, wait, sorry, what? No, I didn't get asked to do a PR meeting. An interview for... Okay, what? Hello, yeah. No, I didn't get asked to do that before. I'm actually quite busy right now with some deadlines. 10 minutes. I'm sorry. I'm supposed to be having my lunch soon, actually, and I'm not even ready. Like I've done my makeup, and there's no other day you can do it. Right, for the diversity panel, yeah. Yeah, okay, that's fine. Yeah, sure. Yeah, see you soon. Hello, Mom.
Amma Amowa, is this your voice I'm hearing? Here I thought something must have happened to my daughter.
Mom, I'm sorry I haven't replied to your messages. I've been really busy.
Amma, how could you miss the wedding? Your cousins are still upset with you.
Sorry, Mom. I've had these crazy deadlines and I had to redo some of Jamie's work. If I didn't do it, it wouldn't have gotten done.
Even a simple reply, amen, to the prayers I sent you on WhatsApp. Are you too busy for Jesus?
No, Mum, of course not. It's promotion season, you know, and I've just been so caught up in work.
Amma, you sound sick. Have you been eating well?
I'm fine. I'm okay.
Are you sure that's all?
No, Mum, I feel terrible. I don't think I can do this anymore. It's just all these deadlines, Mum. Mum, you know, I'm actually thinking of resigning. Sorry, Mum, I just don't think I can do it anymore. It's just so much to get done, and it's like I'm doing all of Jamie's work and no one even seems to care. Like, I can't sleep, I don't want to eat anything, and honestly, Mum, sometimes my heart beats so fast, I feel like I'm going to have a heart attack. Mum, I'm tired all the time. I'm tired of being tired.
I understand that work isn't easy, but nothing worthwhile in life is. Remember that you are very lucky to have a big role like the one you have at Curtis & Co. In just a few years, by God's grace, you'll become partner. You know your father is old and he'll be retiring soon. I'm not far behind him. Once he retires, we will need you to help support the younger ones. You will get through this, Amma. You are strong.
Amma, I don't feel strong. I don't think I could do this anymore, Mom, honestly.
You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. Don't declare negativity. Eh? Just keep praying, and I will keep praying as well. Our God is a good God.
Mom, I feel terrible. I feel sick. I don't think I can do it.
Eh, Anna? Let's stop talking about this. I don't want you upset, Mom. Okay? Let's move on to a more cheerful topic. Now, your cousin's wedding. Oh, what a beautiful wedding. The food, the jollof rice, the dancing. Oh, she looked beautiful. And you should have seen her go dapper in her suit.
I met a boy, and he was beautiful. He had the brightest blue eyes. Staring into his eyes, it was like swimming in the skies. And his smile, oh, his smile. When God gave him that smile, he gave me the gift of seeing the sun up close. Those dimples proved that something so beautiful couldn't exist without breaking something. The muscles in his cheeks, my carefully built walls, my heart.
Hi Sadie, your email said that you wanted to have a catch-up call.
Breathe.
Yes, I wanted to chat about my holiday request.
Count to three.
Yeah, sorry about that. Unfortunately, I had to reject it because I'd already given the time off to Jenny. You know, she's got kids and she really needs to have the half term off to be with them.
Remind your tongue of its training. Speak slowly.
Yeah, I do understand how important it is for parents to have the school holidays off because I have kids too.
Yeah, you are, aren't you? I'm so sorry, but like I said, I've already given it to Jenny.
I spoke to Jenny about this and she told me that she requested the time off yesterday afternoon. I put in my request at the start of the week using a formal procedure.
Contort your body into a posture that resembles calm. Convince the muscles in your face to take a break.
Well, Jenny and I were chatting in the break room yesterday and I told her I'll give her the leave then. I hadn't checked my emails yet. So unfortunately, Sadie, my hands are tied.
Tell yourself that the volcano erupting in your chest is just a mountain. You can cross mountains.
I'm sorry, Karen, but that just won't do.
Let the lava currently pumping through your veins settle as anxious rocks in the pit of your stomach.
Now, I know how difficult things can be for a single mum, but unfortunately, I can't go back on my word.
Don't let it erupt. Dredge up calm from your core. Remember, it's not just one battle. It's a full-scale war, and you lose if you lose your temper. So breathe.
First of all, Karen, I am not a single mother. My husband has had to take the last three school holidays off and has now used up all his holiday time. I made sure I put in the request as early as possible so that I could make sure I got the time off to be there for my kids this holiday. And I did it using the formal procedure in the employee handbook. By refusing me the time off, then you've broken the procedure.
Don't scream as each of her words makes the cut. Don't flinch. Hold it all in.
No, look, Sadie, there's absolutely no need to be so aggressive. I know you're unhappy, but I've given the days to Jenny and there's nothing I can do about it now. I've got another meeting I need to go to, so you're just going to have to let this go.
Don't cry. Turn your palms to the sky. Pray for grace.
The first time I saw it, it was when we visited his parents. He kept mentioning where I worked. I thought it was because he was proud of me. But then, when his mother made that comment about how my people, and he responded, well, Kemi works for Summer Spring, so she isn't like that. That's when I realized that my job was a safety blanket, a white flag, an excuse to bring the black girl home. The second time I saw it was when we went for dinner with his friends. One of his friends asked, is it true what they say? Once you go black, you never go back. He actually responded. He said he'd always loved the taste of chocolate. The third and final time I saw it, we were going for an event at his office. It was wash day and my twister was on its best behavior. Big bouncy afro curls. And then he asked me if I was going like that. Like what? With my hair. Like that. It wasn't actually what he said. It was how he said it. With that look on his face as if my hair was a stench he couldn't bring around his colleagues. This was best behavior twist out. He did not deserve best behavior twist out.
Hi, Emma. Thank you for joining us today.
No worries.
And we really appreciate your patience during this application process. Your hard work definitely hasn't gone unnoticed.
That's okay.
While you were one of our strongest contenders for the promotion, unfortunately at this time the panel has decided to move forward with another candidate.
Right, okay. Sorry, may I ask why?
Sure, to be honest it was pretty much neck and neck, so we decided to look at the bigger picture. The panel felt that the other candidate, and I guess I can tell you now because it will be announced shortly, Jamie, would be a more decisive leader, and that's what we need going into the next quarter.
Sorry. Jamie. Okay.
We trust that you'll help support him as he transitions into his new role.
Yeah, yeah. Of course, yeah.
White fragility is my manager's epic breakdown when I say the word discrimination in our meeting with HR. It's the quiver in her voice as she says, racist? Me? Never! As though it's more painful to be accused of being racist than to be a victim of racism. It's the two wide-eyed women who make me repeat my version of events multiple times, asking me if I'm sure I want to move forward with this accusation, telling me it's a serious accusation. It's them treating her like the victim and me as the attacker. It's the fact she never apologized. It's the fact the words I'm sorry never crossed her mind. She was too preoccupied with feeling sorry for herself. Thank you.
No is a doing word, a deliberate act of defiance.
No, like Rosa did when they asked her to move to the back of the bus.
No, like Michelle Obama did when she refused to be America's caricature.
No, like Michaela Cole did when Netflix wouldn't give her a seat at the table.
No, like Meghan when she decided to live in an institution that didn't protect her.
No, like Emma, when she would not do twice the work for half the rewards.
No, like Shade did when she refused to let discrimination slide.
No, like Kemi, who decided not to love a boy who couldn't love all of her.
One word.
Two letters.
A weapon of rebellion.
No,